I'm Anthony Brandt, and I'm here today with Harvey Shapiro, who's an old friend of mine and a writer and a poet that I respect enormously. He's written 12 books of poetry. This is his latest, The Sights Along the Harbor, New and Collected Poems, published by the University of Wesleyan Press, or Wesleyan University Press, about a year ago or a year or two ago. Harvey, you're more than just a poet. You've done a lot of things in your career. I've tried to pick up on some of the early work that you did. I know you edited a magazine before you went to work for The Times. Is that right?
When I was in college, I was an editor of something called the Yale Poetry Review, which was just an undergraduate magazine that went out into the world. And actually, we published a lot of Wallace Stevens.
Really?
And William Carlos Williams. Because this was in the late 40s. Uh-huh. And they didn't really have that many magazines that were hospitable to them. Uh-huh. So they were pleased to be published for nothing.
Right.
And in fact, Stevens at one point gave us some money. I remember he gave a lecture at the Museum of Modern Art on writing and painting, I think, and they gave him a check, an honorarium for $150, and he asked them to forward it to us.
Oh, how nice!
And then when I was teaching, which I did briefly before I went into journalism, I was teaching at Cornell, and I was an editor of Epoch.
Epic, I remember, which still goes on. Right.
I was an editor of that magazine. And then I worked for the Village Voice when it started out, but I wasn't an editor. I was on salary. I was poetry editor of the Voice and ad salesman.
Ad salesman?
Yeah.
Really? Well,
actually,
great.
On a small salary because Stan Wolf, who started the newspaper with Ed Fancher, was a buddy of mine, and he gave me the job. I was teaching at Queens at night, I think, and working for The Voice during the day. But my first real professional editing job was for Commentary magazine.
Oh, okay. You started with Commentary then.
And then I moved over to The New Yorker as a fiction editor.
Uh-huh.
I was there for a while and then wandered over to the New York Times where I was in 1957. I started editing. I was at the New York Times magazine.
Okay. Now, you never, I always wondered about this. You started at the Times. You were never a reporter, is that right?
I was never a reporter, that's right. I was never trained in journalism, never went to journalism school.
Right.
My one talent as an editor was I was a good line editor.
Uh-huh. Well, they're very valuable. I can tell you from experience.
Right.
A line editor can save your life.
Well, that
as a writer.
That was my skill, and that paid the rent.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, were you born in New York City?
No, I was born in Chicago.
But you seem to be identified with New York from a very early age. You talk in some of your poems about growing up on Riverside Drive.
That's true.
Did you move when you were
a boy? Yeah, I was very young when the family moved. My family was sort of based in Chicago. And then we moved to Lower East Side. I think I lived on Delancey Street. And then as my father, I guess, acquired some funds, we moved up to Riverside Drive and West End Avenue. Then we actually a spell out in the suburbs. During the Depression, my family moved out.
Now, you went to Yale before the war, is that right?
I was in the class of 45.
Okay.
So my freshman year was Pearl Harbor.
Yeah. Now, I wondered, I knew you'd been in the war, and I knew you'd been a radio gunner in B-17s?
Yeah.
Over Italy.
Well, no, we were based in Italy.
You flew over Germany.
We flew over Germany and Austria. The heavy bombers, we were heavy bombers. B-17s were heavy. I was in the 15th Air Force, which headquartered was in Bari, but our field was in Foggia, southern Italy. And we would get up early in the morning if we were on a mission that day, and go to briefing. We would mass over Italy, and then fly across the Adriatic into Austria and Germany. Mm-hmm.
The reason I ask is because looking through your collected poems, I was looking for war poems, and they appear in odd times. It wasn't as if you got out of the war and you started writing war poems, or you didn't have your Joseph Heller moment, you know, where you had to write a big, long book about it.
Right.
So you seem to have absorbed the experience of the war in a way that a lot of people maybe did not. I can't tell. I mean, you're a very sane-minded person in some ways. You strike me as being very, very solid in that respect. So I was wondering how big an effect the war had on your sensibility. That's the question I was leading up to. I hope that's...
Well, the war was the experience I shared with my generation.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, we didn't know we were a generation.
Right.
Until some...
Yeah, until you got tagged the greatest
Until we got
of all.
Tagged. we were all in our 20s.
Yeah.
I mean, I think I was 19 or... I was 20 when I was flying, finished my missions. I wasn't a poet.
You were not thinking about being a poet then?
I was always interested in writing.
Yeah.
But, you know, in my first year at Yale, I mean, my major was international relations. I have no idea now why I chose that as my major. Certainly was never going to be a diplomat.
Yeah.
I don't know who I was then.
Yeah.
I came out of the war thinking that I wanted to write. Pretty mm-hmm. sure I wanted to write. And I did start to write in my senior year at Yale. And then I had a year at Columbia, and then I had a year living on GI self-employment, and I was writing mm-hmm. poetry. I mean, I had decided I was going to be a poet.
Did you have poems in the Yale Poetry Review at that time?
Yeah, a few. Oh. Yeah, I did. And I was a member of the Yale Literary Magazine. And
right.
That my dear friend recently died, Roger Shattuck, edited. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
But... The war, certainly the war changed me. I mean, mm-hmm. it for some reason or other, sort of flying at high altitude and being in combat, it does sharpen the mind.
Yes.
You know, it clarifies certain things.
Prospect of being
I mean,
a
I came, yes, I came back knowing that I wanted to write.
Yes.
And some of my... earliest poems when I came back were attempts to write war poetry.
Uh-huh.
And my poem Battle Report is, which is a poem I developed over the years.
Yeah,
was
it comes late in your work.
Was started, but it was started.
Early on.
Yeah, it was started early on. and it kind of developed. I would say the war was a crucial experience for me. It's not that I had. It bonded me, with a lot of people.
Yeah.
It certainly changed the way. After I was a survivor.
Mm-hmm.
So I was when I was 21, I was a survivor.
Yeah.
I'm still a survivor.
Right, right. There's that strain all through
yeah,
your work.
Yeah.
Which is I've made it through another day.
And I even when I was going through my collected stuff here, I noticed that even in an early poem, this is not about the war. It's an early love poem called The Heart. And it gives you an idea of my style, but this is a love poem, and I notice I have to revert to sort of military metaphors.
Oh, okay.
The heart. In the midst of words, your wordless image marches through the precincts of my night, and all the structures of my language lie undone. The bright cathedrals clatter, and the moon-topped spires break their stalk. Sprawled before that raid, I watch the towns go under, and in the waiting dark, I loose like marbles spinning from a child, the crazed and hooded creatures of the heart. Still like that poem.
It's a nice poem, yeah. And the image of flying over that landscape.
Yeah. But you can see the military runs through the whole.
Right. Right.
The whole thing.
Right. Now, you published your first book in 1953, is that right?
Right, The Eye.
Yeah. And I read through those poems that are in this book that you chose for your collected poems. Your style was very different. It was seemed like a 50s style to me. There was a lot more of not so much formality. You weren't writing rhyme poems in the way that those very formal poems of the 50s, those almost scholastic poems,
right,
in a funny way. But you did have the same kind of tone, which was, how shall I describe it? It's a more mannered style. Yeah. And then your style changes, and it does so fairly quickly into something that is incredibly direct, and no kind of bluster, no beating around the bush. If you got something to say, you say it, and you say it straight out, and you say it in such a way that's very powerful. Was that a change that you were aware of at the time? Did you make, was it a conscious change? When I was preparing for this, I was looking at that, and I think it's like Yeats around 1910 or 15, when he completely changed his style from the Lake Isle of Innisfree style to something much, in a way, blunter. And I'm curious, how did that happen with you?
Well, I'd like to be like Yeats at any point.
No, you're pretty, okay.
In his career.
Not Yeats, yeah. But you're pretty good, Harvey. You really are.
But, I'm sure when I started writing, it was the age of Eliot.
Yeah.
We all took our directions, really, from Eliot. And we were schooled in the metaphysicals.
Mm-hmm.
17th century. Tired. 17th century poets were in. You weren't supposed to read the Romantics.
No.
Keats and Shelley were out.
Right.
And
and the Victorians were
Milton was out.
And the Victorians were a scandal.
Right.
Yes.
You know, I was reading a lot of Donne.
Mm-hmm.
Still read a lot of Donne. And my style was probably, as you say, reflected some of the period. That does happen. Although it was probably a mix. I don't know who the influential poets on me were then, but they were probably a mix of people like Dylan Thomas,
mm-hmm.
who was great vogue then, 17th century poets I was reading, Eliot, of course. I did write some, I didn't rhyme, but I did, well, I have a villanelle in the book.
I noticed
that. I did work in forms. And then there was a point when I realized that in my style, in the style that I was using, I couldn't use the first person.
Uh-huh.
It was very okay. hard for me to say I.
Right.
And also that there were experiences that I wanted to get down. I mean, there were stories
right.
now that I wanted to tell. And I couldn't tell them using the style I was then writing in.
Mm-hmm.
And that I had to change in order to accommodate this experience. I had to change the way I wrote my poems in order to accommodate this experience, or I'd lose it.
Right.
And that was a fairly conscious shift.
Uh-huh.
That's true. Now, you know, it's not, I mean, it's true my work is direct, but my language is stylized, I would say.
Well.
Okay.
Every poet's language
is stylized. Yes, every poet. And I still love rich rhetoric.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm a big reader of Milton, and I still love that open vowel, organ stop,
right.
tone, and try to get it
yeah.
every once in a while in my work.
Uh-huh. I remember being in college and doing a piece on Christopher Marlowe's imagery.
Yeah,
and my professor. After I had done, and he liked the piece. But he pointed out something that I've never forgotten. He said, here's Milton talking about trumpets, and he describes it as sonorous metal blowing martial sounds.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, and here's Shakespeare, silver snarling trumpets. And the contrast,
right.
it really defines Milton as much as it defines
yes, yes.
anybody.
True, that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it has its appeal. It doesn't appeal to me very much, but
right.
I've never been able to finish Paradise Lost.
Ah, great poem.
Is that a terrible thing to admit?
No, no.
Well, I feel a little embarrassed by it. So, you've produced steadily since then. Is there a day... Tell me a little bit about your writing habits. Do you write every day?
Well.
I mean, not everybody. Obviously, nobody can write every day if they're sick or if they're traveling or
yeah.
whatever. But
well, now, you know, I'm going to be 87 in January. So my habits have changed. So
mm-hmm.
When you're older, you know, you don't write. It's hard to work in poetry every day there. Isn't much that an older man can do. You go on tour with the Rolling Stones, and your choices are kind of limited.
Right.
But I try to write now, but I don't work at a regular schedule. The bulk of my poetry was written when I had a job,
mm-hmm.
and I worked up until. 8 or 9 years ago, really.
Mm-hmm.
And I would come home at night and have dinner, talk to my wife, my then wife, and children. And I would go up to my study. I had a house, I had a house in Brooklyn Heights. I'd moved there about 50 years ago. And I had a study. I'd go there at about 11 o'clock at night. I kept a bottle of bourbon and some beer in a little refrigerator up there that I'd used to elevate me a bit so I could start writing. And I'd work till about 1:30 or 2 in the morning.
Wow.
And I did that consistently.
Well, it's quiet then.
And I'd write in my notebooks, and even if I were faced with an empty page and an empty head, I would write whatever came into my subconsciously. That is, I would probe this. I would just let myself write.
Yeah.
And I would fill pages that way. And then maybe a lot of my poems were written that way. I'd go back a week later and I would start, because I was now a trained editor, this is where my journalism experience fed my poetry writing. I was able to pick out the lines in a sort of mass of junk, the lines that seemed to cohere and were making a poem. And I would take them out, and I would see that over the week or the weeks, a poem had been developing. And I'd put those lines together, almost like seeing film strip, and everything is dark, and then here and there and there, there's a frame that opens up, and that is light, and that is usable. A lot of my poems were put together really editing through junk.
That's interesting.
And finding the lines that were beginning to make, that carried emotional freight. That's what a poet has to learn to do, is to know when you, it's a little like fishing. When you've got a catch, when you got something live at the end of the line, you can feel that.
Yeah, you feel a little tug.
And more than a little tug. Yeah. You feel there's a weight of stuff, you know, something fighting there that you have to bring out, bring up. Or another poet, a friend of mine, George Oppen, said when he came to a class of mine that I was, workshop I was doing in writing, and a student asked him, how do you know when you've got a first line? And he said, well, you know when you can jump up and down on it. Same.
Yeah.
Same thing.
And how long would it normally take? Obviously, a longer poem is going to take a longer time. But some of your poems are very short. Some of them are 5, 8, 10 lines. Does that take less time, or is there, doesn't it work that way for you?
Well, it doesn't. I mean, a poem that takes five or ten lines probably was written at a sitting, probably. May not have been, but it may have been poem that started with a line that was written some weeks ago or a year ago, and I go back through my notebooks all the time.
Right.
But then comes together rather quickly, but then maybe was scrapped.
You couldn't take it down?
Maybe was scrapped and then rewritten again.
Right.
And then scrapped and then rewritten from the start again.
Right. Right.
Whereas the long poem doesn't develop that way. And it can develop over months or a year sometimes. Or it can be written in your head. I noticed that some of the poems that I have carried in my head are poems that were written in my head. That is actually written on a walk. I know a poem I wrote that's in some anthologies on the death of John Fitzgerald Kennedy, the National Cold Storage Company poem, I wrote in my head walking on the waterfront, Brooklyn waterfront. And when I came back to my study, I just wrote it down.
Really?
And I may have changed a line or two, but it was basically composed in my head. I remember years ago here in East Hampton, going to hear John Hall Wheelock read when he was in his, he was 80. And I remember he read with the book closed and he recited these long poems. And I thought to myself, he's written these poems in his head walking the beach because they were beach poems.
Right.
And that's why they're still there in his head. He doesn't have to look at the page.
Yeah. We're running short of time, unfortunately, because I haven't even asked you about your years at the Times.
That's true.
And or anything like that. But I wonder if there's time for you to read a couple of poems before we shut down here.
Okay.
I'm going to let you choose, although I have a few of my own.
Well.
My own favorites, but.
All right. Some of my poems are city poems, as you say, and some of my poems reflect my life on the East End. I started coming out here in, I came out to the North Fork about 50 years ago.
That's a long time.
And then came to East Hampton several years after that. But this is a poem about Ditch Plain.
Okay. Surfer.
We start with the local. Ditch Plain poem. To be there when day breaks on the sea's reaches. The full moon still hung there. At Ditch Plain, for example, before the surfers appear. Water over rock and gravel. Shingle sound. Beautiful enough in this end of July drought of fish to make me stand there hungry for a text. In the water, on the sand. Something to bring back to my desk like beach glass or polished stone. I want my happiness to be visible. I want to bless this day with meaning. Let the rest of my life take care of itself, so long as I can hover there. Now that poem was out of my experience of fishing.
Mm-hmm.
I like to surf cast. I spent a lot of my time. Surf casting on these. And that's what that comes out of. This is a poem about the war. Something that I saw. And this is partly my journalism at work. This is a scene out of the war. And it's called Italy 1944. That day when we came back from a mission in the field beside the tents where we slept lay a woman and a baby under a blanket. Beside the blanket was a pile of lira notes, a line like a chow line snaked through the field. She was taking them on one by one, a squadron of flight crews and ground crews who could easily get in town whatever they wanted for a loaf of bread or a pack of cigarettes, but preferred to stand in a muddy field, watching and waiting, while a blanket humped and the woman earned whatever it was she had to earn in one day from that war.
Wow.
And I read one other war poem, another short one. Now, this is written years later. As you say,
yeah,
I keep coming back.
They're scattered, yeah.
Because I look. I mean, I keep, there's stories that I find
right.
I haven't told. I just, a couple of weeks ago, wrote a poem about the war.
Yeah.
The things I haven't been able to say yet. This was on a visit that I made in 1996 to Italy,
mm-hmm.
to Lucca. I was in Lucca, Italy, when I wrote this. Italy, 1996. This Italian earth is special to me. Because I was here in a war when I was young and immortal. I remember the cypresses in the early morning light on the road to the airfield, before the sky filled with toiling planes, massing high over Italy for the perilous crossing to Germany. I remember on the way back from the target, toasting my frozen cheese sandwich, frozen by the high altitude, on the electrically heated casing of my 50 caliber machine gun. I remember the taste of life.
Yeah.
That's not a celebration of war, but it means that life, the taste of life, will always contain some of that danger.
Yeah.
Of facing death.
Yeah.
For me.
Yeah.
That's do we have room for
Absolutely.
Time for another?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I read some a late poem or two from the book.
Yeah.
This is called Cathedral. I went out and this thought rose before me like a great cathedral. And it said, transcendence, transcendence, or at least try a bit harder.
Yes, I remember.
That's one of the
that.
Short poems.
Yeah.
That you referred
to. You have
to.
Another one with that.
And this is a poem called Desk. After my death, my desk, which is now so cluttered, will be bare wood, simple and shining, as I wanted it to be in my life, as I wanted my life to be. And I'll read one more. This is a humorous poem, but like a lot of my poetry, it's a city poem. And when you're walking through New York, there are all these found poems, things that you see, something you overhear, something that somebody says to you,
right?
And they instantly become poems. This is called New York Notes. Caught on a side street in heavy traffic, I said to the cabbie, I should have walked. He replied, I should have been a doctor. "When can I get on the 11:33? I asked the guy in the information booth at the Atlantic Avenue station. "When they open the doors," he says, "I am home among my people."
Yes, I was hoping you would read that. I love that poem. Harvey, one thing I haven't asked you about yet is that as I was reading your book, more and more you turn to Jewish themes and you talk about your tribe. And I find it, it's interesting to see you turn that way, but it's also, the poems are really good. And I'm wondering, was that something that you, again, consciously decided to do? Or did it just start to happen as you got older?
I wrote Jewish poems very early on because my family was, my grandmother lived with us, and for that reason, I think we were somewhat religious.
Mm-hmm.
I did go to synagogue regularly. And I was, when I started writing, I mean, I remember there was a period when I wanted to write poems that got back to primitive ideas of religion, that took the Sunday school stories and got back to their archaic, primitive roots.
Right.
And I wrote a whole series of poems called Mountain Fire Thornbush based on that.
Right.
Recently, I had the great good fortune to contribute to a book that Norton is bringing out in December of Anglo-Saxon poetry. And I got to translate first two chapters of Genesis from the Anglo-Saxon into contemporary English verse.
Uh-huh.
And they're about the world before creation. That's a time I'm very comfortable with for some mm-hmm. reason.
Mm-hmm.
I love creation myths, and I love that period before creation. And so, and I got to do that, and there's the earliest English rendering that we have. But yes, I've written Jewish poetry all my life.
And yet it doesn't seem like religious poetry. It's not worshipful poetry.
It's no, because it's hard to be worshipful after the Holocaust,
right.
And after the war. But it's questioning. I mean, some of the early poems were fairly ceremonially Jewish. I mean,
mm-hmm.
there are one or two for the holidays that are almost liturgical
mm-hmm.
very early on, but they change. Yeah.
They change. Well, you changed,
yes,
clearly.
Yes, I changed.
Yeah. And we should talk, too, while we have the little time we have left. You spent 8 years as the book review editor of the New York Times, the Sunday Times book review. And I remember when I first heard of you, you were Harvey Shapiro. You were the editor of the Sunday Times book review, and that I thought, that's got to be one of the most powerful jobs in the literary world. You must feel that, holding such a job, that it's a huge responsibility. You choose the books that are going to be reviewed, and you toss out the books that are not going to be reviewed. And every writer has to think, holy cow. I'm sure it must have been an incredible experience in your social life, in your working life. I mean, tell me a little bit about it. I've never been in such a position in a major way. I've edited the essays for the Pushcart Prize, but it's hardly the same.
Right. Yes, it did. It did indeed affect my social life. I remember at one point when I was editing the book review, there was a woman I was going with. In fact, living with her at one point, and I think we were at a party at Roger Strauss's house, publisher.
Mm-hmm.
Strauss, for our parents' stress. And some writers were trying to get to talk to me. And to get to me, they knocked her over.
They pushed her to the floor?
She fell on the sofa.
Oh, no.
She refused to go out with me after that.
That's very funny.
No, it did get in the way of my social life. Yes, well, I had been at the Times for years before then. Right. I was, you know, I started in 57 as an editor of the magazine. Suddenly, I was in this position of editing my own section. I had been a deputy editor to the magazine. And before we get to the book review, I must say that if I go back to that period in dreams, I'm usually at the magazine.
Really?
Well, I spend more time there.
Yeah.
And in a way, one could be more creative at the magazine. I had more power at the book review, that's true.
Right, right.
I had the power to choose books. But at the magazine, one could get up with a thought in the morning and come to the office and present the idea to the other editors,
mm-hmm.
and have it accepted, and get a writer and get photographers, and several weeks later see it as a big spread in the magazine.
Right.
That's a big kick.
Yeah, I've never been in that position, but I can imagine.
And also, you know, an editor can pick up, if you're working at the Times, you can pick up the phone.
Right.
And talk to damn near anybody.
Yeah.
And I remember probably the most useful thing I did in all my years at the Times was to one morning get up and when I got to the office, I called a Southern Leadership Conference. This was during the civil rights struggle.
Mm-hmm.
And I suggested to them that it might be useful for Martin Luther King to write a poem from jail. Next time he was jailed in Alabama.
Oh, boy.
And that became Letter from a Birmingham Jail.
Wow.
And they credited me with that.
That's got suggestion. To be a fabulous feeling.
That.
Yeah.
I feel very good about that.
Yeah.
All right, to come to the book review. Yeah, that was a funny position for me to be in because I came out of the world of journalism, but I also came out of the world of little magazines and poetry, all of which had nothing to do
with
high-powered
political
publishing.
And big novels and...
I was determined as editor to please the Sunday reader. I realized my audience were the readers of the New York Times Sunday newspaper. But I also had to please myself. I had to keep myself interested. I knew that was important for my own psyche. And... so I had to weigh my interests against the interests of the average reader and against the interests of the publishing industry, which I could hear muttering in the background.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I remember once I put an anthology of Chinese poetry on the cover of the book review.
Really?
Yeah. Well, it was a great anthology, Sunflower Splendor.
Oh, yeah, I remember
years
that.
Of Chinese, great Chinese poetry. And I had a friend of mine... David Lattimore, Owen's son, do the review. He was teaching then at Brown, a classical Chinese, and I did.
He's the same person who translated the Greek tragedies.
No, that's.
That's another Lattimore.
That's a different Lattimore. That's Owen's brother.
Richard
Lattimore,
okay.
Who did the Odyssey and the. Great Iliad translation.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, the best.
Yeah, same family. Yeah.
What a family.
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah. But anyhow, that was not a popular choice. Because the publishing industry thinks of the front page of the book review as a way to sell books. I had to think of it as a way to bring attention to what I felt was the most important book of the week. And occasionally that was poetry. I remember I had a Seamus Heaney book. I split a cover once with a field work, I think, of Seamus's, and a book by Anthony Hecht.
Two poets, right?
Two great poets. Seamus is still with us, luckily.
Right, right. Would you read a final poem for us?
Okay. I haven't read any of the poems of mine that do strike, strike a Jewish note. This one does, even though the title is out of Donne, Riding Westward is a great poem of his. Riding Westward. It's holiday night, and crazy Jews are on the road, finished with fasting and high on prayer. On either side of the Long Island Expressway, the lights go spinning like the twin ends of my talus. Perhaps I can make it, I hope I can make it to Utopia Parkway, where my father lies at the end of his road, and then home to Brooklyn. Jews, departure from the law is equivalent to death. Shades, we greet each other darkly on the Long Island Expressway, where I say my own prayers for the dead, crowded in Queens, remembered in Queens, as far away as Brooklyn. Cemeteries break against the city like seas, a white froth of tombstones, or like schools of herring, still desperate to escape the angel of death. Entering the city, you have to say memorial prayers as he slides overhead, looking something like my father approaching the ark as the gates close on the Day of Atonement. Here in the car and in Queens and in Brooklyn.
Thank you. We're going to wrap this up. I'm Anthony Brandt again. I'm here with Harvey Shapiro, and we've been talking about poetry for a while, and we've missed a lot. We could have talked about many other things.
Yes, we could.
But I've had a wonderful time, and I hope you've enjoyed it too. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.